church family, great to have you with us. We're here to worship a holy God. Habakkuk says, Lord, I've heard of your fame. I stand in awe of your deeds, Lord. Repeat them in our day. In our time, make them known. In wrath, remember mercy. Can I invite you to stand in the presence of our holy God and remember his greatness for a quiet moment before we sing that great hymn that reminds us of the holiness of God. you touch the right hand one, you're dead. It is, in fact, a stonefish. And the left hand one is a guppy. Now, hopefully, can I just ask, is anyone still alive? Most of us are dead. There is a point to this morning's thing, because I want to give you two options. Some people say there are only two options to what we think, what we say, what we do, because everything stems from one of two options. So what is your choice? Well, far better than that. But sometimes what we think, what we say, what we do is not rooted in love, it's rooted in hate. So I want to turn you to turn to the person nearest you or behind you or in front of you. Come up with three things that are loving and three things that are really not very nice. In terms of behaviour, we're talking about behaviour, nothing about type and state.
Valentine's Day.
That's not what I had in mind. I was talking about behaviours.
Behaviours.
So I'm cooking for you, Charles. Okay. Now, boys, might be beans on toast. Yeah. Take it to them in bed. Yeah. Olivia. Being kind. Okay. Yeah, it's nice, isn't it?
That's nice.
Sorry? Giving you chocolate. We'll see what we can do. If I'm feeling loving tomorrow. No, you're not in tomorrow. Tuesday. Things that are hateful or rooted in your dinner's in the dog. Olivia. Sorry? Being negative, yeah. Discrimination.
War.
Unkind words. We don't think that's a behaviour. And I would quite like one. I'm quite happy to have it. People say that we have one of two options, either to root every thought, word, and deed in what is loving, because if we don't, it's rooted in hate. We only have two options. And that's quite challenging, isn't it, when you think about the way that we've behaved over the past week. Has every thought, word, and being loving, as our holy God is, or have we thought, said, or done something that was rooted in hate? Let's just be quiet for a moment as I give us all the opportunity to ask God to forgive us if there's anything that we need to bring to God. Father, forgive us for what we have done wrong. Help us to root every thought, word, and deed in your light, so that we can reflect your holiness. Amen. And so, I want us to recognize, joining up with last week, which was on the theme of the cross, that the cross can help change every thought, word, and deed from what is hateful to what is loving. This is the good news of Jesus Christ. You can make a difference. So let's sing, How Can I Be Free From Sin? I think it's absolutely wonderful, absolutely exciting that no matter what we've done, we can be forgiven. There is true power in the cross to remove every stain of sin from us. I think we thought about it last week. But we can walk free, forgiven, with the possibility of being covered in the righteousness of God and reflecting his glory. And so we have to respond, thank you for the cross.
Thank you. Seems
of sin from us. We thank you that no matter how sinful we've been, your mercy is more. We say to you, hallelujah. How wonderful you are to forgive us so completely. Amen. Please do be seated. As you came in, you should have. As you came in, you should have received a postcard. And we've been encouraging people to take the prompts on the table and to swap them each week and pray for opportunities during the week under the guidance of the Holy Spirit to be a witness for Jesus. Whether it answers the prompt card or it's something completely different, it doesn't matter so long as we increase our spiritual sensitivity to how God might be using us. Marcus is coming next week, and it will be great to have a lot of responses of how over the past year we've seen answers to prayer when we prayed for God to prompt us to seize the opportunity. So if you could bring the postcard back, you don't have to put a name to it, it's optional. Just how God's given you an opportunity over the past year, whether directly in relation to a prompt card or something else, that would be really great. And it's often when we hear people's stories that we get inspired, encouraged, we think, oh, I could do that. Or it's really, really easy. I think Tim and I met on Monday night, was it? And I can't remember what my prompt card is. Another one and been praying for that. It was something to do with your neighbour. How can you do something for your neighbour? And just as I was coming out on Monday, no, I was here, wasn't I? Our neighbour texted us saying, can you do something for us? So it was kind of, I didn't have to work too hard at this, but I fulfilled what it said on my prompt card. Thank you, Jesus, for making it so easy. Sometimes it's recognizing that God in his goodness makes it so easy for us when we are prayerful. So bring those back. Marcus is here next week. Gospel surveys, we're going to have a meal afterwards. Sign up by the end of today. Do you know what I'm going to say now? Those of you who are regular know what I'm going to say. So I won't say it. If you're visiting, there will be grace extended if you haven't signed up. So sign up by the end of the day. That's great. And a week tomorrow, we're having a day of prayer and fasting. And over the next few months, we're going to use the verse 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people will call by my name, will humble themselves and pray, and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, etc. The danger is with a verse like this, you rush on to the blessing rather than deal with the four conditions of the blessing. And as we were praying through this, we felt we should pause at each of the conditions. And so a week tomorrow, we'll be thinking about if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves. And so if you find this helpful, great. If you don't, use whatever means possible. But just spend some time before God, asking him, how might you need to respond that call to humble yourself? How we as a church might be called to respond to how we should humble ourselves before Almighty God. At 8 o'clock, there's a time of prayer in the church where whether you've heard from God or not, you're able to feedback, we're able to pray in to what we sense God has been saying to us. So we're going to humble ourselves. In November, it's going to be pray. In January, it'll be seek my face. I think that's right, Carol, I'm looking at you. And February is turn from our wicked ways. And then we'll begin to go on to the three blessings that this verse promises. So we just want to respond to this as on a number of days of prayer and fasting over the years, people have come with this verse and said it's something that the church needs to consider. So we feel it's time and right to use it. So day of prayer and fasting a week on Monday. Let's pray for those things before we move on to pray for something else. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you give each and every one of us the opportunity to be your witnesses. However that is, we thank you for the way that it's often so very easy. And forgive us for the times when we make it such a big deal that we scare ourselves out of stepping forward in faith. We thank you for the numerous answers to prayer we've had over the past year. Help us to be brave enough to tell our stories, to share it with other people, to encourage them so that they might think, I can take that step of faith. Lord, we pray that you'd help us in our sharing next week. That Marcus would inspire us, and we dare to pray that people would respond to the good news of Jesus. Father, we thank you for the opportunity as a church to humble ourselves and pray and seek your face and turn from our wicked ways. Lord, we thank you that you are so gracious, that you ask us to roll up our sleeves and do business with you. And so, Father, over the next few months as we do that, Lord, we pray that you'd speak to us. Lord, we believe that you want to prosper us, to give us a hope and a future. And so we pray that our eyes will be firmly fixed on you, the God who is so holy but so gracious, as we do this. Amen. I want us to carry on in prayer. And we pray for people as they go to work. Thank you. And each 6 or 7 weeks we send out fresh paper. It looks something like this. I know you can't see it, so I've tried to project it, but it's no script on the front. And we send it out to about 6 people going to work. And so it takes about 5 or 6 or 7 weeks to get through everyone who is working. So there's my list. Sandra already has sent in her request for this week. So exciting when we're praying for Charles to see how last minute he is sending his request through. We wait on a Monday morning with eager anticipation for his email, WhatsApp, text, or whatever things we're going to get. We hope we've caught everyone, but if you've come or your name isn't on the list or you don't get a prayer card just reminding you that we're praying for you, do have a word with. Your work is so vitally important. Can you actually read that? Yeah. So I want you to pray for someone near you who is going to work. So maybe the person sat next to you. If you're joyfully retired. And this is not a concern, you may have to look further afield. Just choose someone. You can use what we're praying for people this coming 5 or 6 weeks, or you can choose your own prayer. Let's just pray for those that are going to work. Heavenly Father, we lift up all those amongst our congregation who go to work. They're not there by accident. And so we pray for them that their work would be fulfilling and joyful, that they would be overcomers and victorious when facing challenges, that they will be a blessing to their company and to their colleagues, that they would find their work deeply rewarding. Lord, we commit them to you. And Father, we continue to want to pray for those areas that are experiencing conflict, and we pray particularly for Israel and Palestine at this moment. And we pray for peace in that area. Lord, as we've looked at the cross and the power to forgive, oh, how those two groups of people need to forgive one another. And so we pray for an outpouring of your Spirit to bring about reconciliation and healing. And as our newspapers are dominated by what's going on, we don't forget what's happening in Ukraine. But nothing untoward would happen because they think they can get away with it. But again, we pray that these two countries would move towards peace. Lord, we pray for an end to this senseless violence, to this taking of human life, to these people, whatever side of the divide they live, who are made in your image, who are precious to you. Lord, help us to love and value all. I'm going to read from God's Word from 1 Timothy chapter 3. 1 Timothy chapter 3, hopefully verses 1 to 12. And if someone would like to read, that's fine. Oh, I really appreciate that, is what I mean. And Rob has the microphone and I'm happy to run around to help you be heard. Right, I'm not cooking today, so I can wait as long as I want. Thank you, Andy.
Qualifications of overseers. This is a faithful saying. If a man desires the position of a bishop, he desires a good work. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, temperate, sober-minded, of good behavior, hospitable, able to teach, not given to wine, not violent, not greedy, money, but gentleness, not quarrelsome, not covetous. One who rules his own house well, having his children in submission with all reverence. For if a man does not know how to rule his own house, how will he take care of the church of God? Not a novice, lest he be puffed up with pride, he fall into the same condemnation as the devil. Moreover, he must have a good testimony among those who are outside, lest he fall into reproach and the snare of the devil. Qualifications of deacons. Likewise, deacons must be reverent, not double-tongued, not given to much, not greedy for money, holding the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience. But let these also first be tested. Then let them serve as deacons, be found blameless. Likewise, their wives must be reverent, not slanderous, temperate, faithful in all things. Let the deacons be the husbands of one wife, ruling their
case you don't recognise him, John Owen was born in 1616. He was a theological giant among his contemporaries. Even today, his 23 thick volumes are still in print, inspiring people to live passionately for God. He was a man of incredible activity. Politically, as Oliver Cromwell's chaplain and frequent speaker to Parliament, denominationally, as a man for all controversies between Congregational and Presbyterian Puritans, theologically, as the foremost Puritan defender of Calvinist truth, academically, as Dean and Vice Chancellor of the University of Oxford, pastorally, serving churches in and around London almost all his adult life, even when it was illegal to gather, and personally, with a family of 11 children, 10 who died when they were young, and the 11th when she was a young adult. Now, sometimes we look at these great big loads and think they must have life so easily. But he knew what grief and sorrow was. But that didn't stop his passionate pursuit of God. In the midst of all his activity, his passion was not public performance, but personal holiness. He said, "My heart's desire unto God and the chief design of my life are that universal holiness may be promoted in my own and in the hearts and minds of others." His commitment was holiness. I wonder what the chief design What do you consider your most important pursuit? What priority do you give to holiness? We continue our series on spiritual passions, and this morning we're looking at holiness. And three things I want to look at: holiness, the priority; holiness, the pursuit; and holiness, the point. First thing I want to look at is holiness, the priority. And I realise Colin's in the congregation, and I should have run this illustration past him first, but this is what it said on the internet, which is not a good defence of anything you find on the internet. But the sun, the temperature of the sun is 15 million degrees centigrade, he would say. It's so hot that a pinhead heated to the temperature of the centre of the sun would emit enough heat to kill anyone who ventured within 1,000 miles of it. I mean, that's kind of a colossal statement. A pinhead kill you up to 1,000 miles. And some complained the basket was hot. When we talk of the holiness of God, even the centre of the sun pales in comparison. That's what one of the songwriters said this morning. God is so utterly holy that his holiness is described as a consuming fire. All through the Bible we have this charge: be holy because I am holy. And the biblical picture of the life of holiness is that it is so consuming it has an impact on the lives of those around it. Holiness should be a priority, and it begins with God. So the next few minutes may be a little dense to roll up your sleeves. Holiness is a priority because God is holy. His character is holy. His actions are holy, his thoughts are holy, his words are holy, his justice is holy, and he is the epitome of holiness. The holiness of God is so far beyond human comprehension that language miserably fails to convey these truths. The infinite holiness of God may be the hardest thing for finite minds like you and me to grasp and explain. Nevertheless, we're called to know something of his holiness that surpasses knowledge. That's a difficult task, isn't it? The answer is yes, John. God's holiness means that he is free from any form of corruption, fault or error, free from any outside influence that affects his nature or character that might deflect him in any sort of way, free from any need outside of himself. Lord remains perfectly consistent and uniform in his being, so in his holiness he is able to say, I, the Lord, do not change. And the good news of that is when we come before a holy God, we will always encounter holiness. Why? Because I, the Lord, do not change. You're always going to have an encounter with holiness. And the Lord's holiness speaks of his ethical or moral perfection. Whatever God does, he remains true to his holiness. His justice is based on his infinite ethical qualities and his limitless knowledge. He makes no mistakes. His moral perfection is actually who he is, not something he does. He never sinned, and even more than that, evil is totally absent from his being. Having grasped something of that, the angels fall down and worship. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And I've said this before, and I'll say it again. This is the one aspect of the character of God that is repeated this way. Not love, not mercy, not grace, not anything else. It's holiness that is repeated in the throne room of heaven. What aspect, what character of God really, really matters? If you haven't got it, it's holiness. In the presence of a holy God, we recognize how unholy we are. And the ancients understood something of the consuming nature of God's holiness. In the presence of a holy God, Isaiah cried out, woe to me, I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips. Paul wrestles with the fact that he's been forgiven. He's been given a new nature, yet the old nature still wages war against himself. So he behaves in a way that is inconsistent with his new identity. He says, I do not understand what I do, but what I want to do, holiness, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. He despairs. What a wretched man am I? I know what our new identity is in Christ, and we need to hold on to that. But in the presence of our holy God, and I know the cross changes everything, are you prepared to say, what a wretched man am I? What a wretched woman am I? Because before a holy God, his holiness exposes every sinful thought, word, and deed in our being. Good news, if you read Isaiah 6, as soon as Isaiah is confronted by the holiness of God and God forgives, Isaiah gets up and goes out on a mission from God. Holiness doesn't debilitate us. It should convict us of how woefully short of God's standard we fall, but it should also pick us up because of our new identity in Christ and send us out. In the presence of our holy God, we're not cringing wrecks, but in that moment of sobriety when we respond, what a wretched man I am, we're picked up, set on our feet, and set going again. So Paul warns, in light of how far short we fall, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment. In the presence of a holy God, we can all say, what a wretched man or woman I am. We're acutely aware of how far short we fall of God's standard, and we are gracious to one another because we speak as broken individuals. In the same way the grace of God is forgiven us, we forgive one another. And we live in this dynamic tension between the wonderful work of Jesus Christ on the cross and our old nature still waging war against us. face this great challenge. In the passage we read from, we see that the priorities are given to those in leadership responsibility in the church. Before any of you get judgmental, as a church that believes in the priesthood of all believers, that means all of us. Have you got that? Look at the qualities of an overseer and deacon. Much of what is required relates to character. Husband of one wife, temperate, self-controlled, respectful, hospitable, not given to drunkenness, not violent, but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. Where has that got to do with the person's competence? The first and most important thing is character, not competence. What the Bible values most highly is character. The trouble is, as people are influenced by the world, we can so often value competence more highly. But character matters more than the economy of God. And so we have to ask the question, is the overseer or deacon being nominated living a holy life? And this is where it gets really uncomfortable. Perhaps where the rubber hits the road the most, family life. Can we pass on our faith to the next generation without engaging in controlling, abusive, and manipulative behaviour? Or fearing being sent on a guilt trip by others in the church, we become domineering in our household in order to guard our reputation. It's one of the greatest challenges and greatest heartaches in parenting, isn't it? We desperately want the next generation to share our faith. And when those who are stand for election as deacons and elders, probably one of the most difficult conversations I have with people is, am I fit as a result of my marriage, of my family home? How does that speak? Because of this passage, you can't lead your own family, how can you lead the church? It can be difficult, isn't it? Really, really difficult, because we know we're not perfect, we're broken individuals. But I want you to grasp this. God values character, holiness, above. The second thing I want to look at is this. Holiness, the pursuit. Yeah, I've missed one of the passages out. Sarah came home from university, and this was the state of her socks. No, that's not Sarah. That's Abigail. Just in case any of you are looking that way. Our response as parents, and Abigail's response as a loving older sister was, Sarah, we'll buy you some socks. She needed to get rid of those old holy socks, but she was having none of it. There are still wares left in them, she said. Don't know what you feel, but I think we'd probably get rid of them. In fact, high on the Christmas list is socks. Absolutely right. But sometimes we can cling onto old things, things that we feel comfortable with, without letting go of old, less holy ones. And this challenge starts with a choice. Do we choose love? Do we choose hate? What do we choose to clothe ourselves with? What do we choose to take off that's not compatible with the character of God? Now, the interesting thing is Galatians, Ephesians, and Colossians were all encouraged to put off the old self and put put on the new self. Language is taken from removing clothes. We're to choose to take off clothing that is unholy and put on clothing that is holy. So taken from Colossians, we're encouraged to take off sexual immorality. That's any unlawful sexual intercourse in the eyes of God. Impurity, which is immoral conduct. Lust, which is inappropriate or shameful passion. Evil desires, longing after something that is unholy. Greed, unhealthy desire for more. Anger, negative outburst or emotion. Wrath, continued state of anger. Malice, a desire for trouble or wickedness to befall the other person. Slander, any form of gossip or defamation against another. Filthy language, obscene or abusive speech. And the passage says, simply take it off. It's like your unholy socks. Don't need to remove them. Just for goodness sake, realize that that form of character needs getting rid of as quickly as possible. One commentator suggested that the removal of clothes is very easy. The removal of all our clothes is easy, isn't it? Well, we've got to try to be shy. But we can remove them very easily. Very easily, can't we? Right, watch me then. Sorry, Rob!
That's right.
Requires many treatments to get rid of it. It leaves a scar at the site you relieve it. And I guess getting rid of some of those characteristics do. It takes a lot of hard work if you've allowed lust, evil desire, greed, and a lot of plans to place in your life. Requires repeated action. It leaves a scar. But we were encouraged to put on holy, and the best way of getting rid of a negative is putting on a positive. So we're encouraged to put on compassion, kindness, humility, compassion. We do not treat people as their sin deserves. Kindness, we abundantly bless with goodness. Humility, we esteem others better than ourselves. Gentleness, in our strength, we consider others and act in their best interest. Patience, we put up with the exasperating conduct of others without anger or wrath. Forgiveness, as God has forgiven, we forgive. Love, this is the bond that binds human relationships. Peace, the result of dressing ourselves in holy clothes. Take off the negative, put on a positive. We know we need to grow in all of that. But isn't there something that God has said to you this morning that you need to take on? That has become an ingrown habit that falls short of the holiness of God. And is there something that you need to put up to make you a more beautiful and holy person? The last thing I want to look at is the point. It's a classic cliche as ever spoken, apparently. When life gives you lemons, make lemonade, apparently. I've never heard of this. I guess they don't grow many lemons around us. But the interesting thing about a lemon is it doesn't naturally occur. It's a hybridization of a bitter orange and a citron. Did you know that? It's been around for thousands of years, but it's the result of the fusion of two other different kinds of fruit. Though we can't be sure, we could say lemons are man-made, as most hybridizations are. One commentator suggested since lemons were selectively bred by humans, it could be said that life doesn't give us lemons,
but rather we make lemons out of life. All too often, by our own poor attitudes, actions, and choices, we end up twisting life circumstances into something bitter, something sour. And it's what the old nature does. As we put on the new clothes of life, we begin to find the fruit of the Spirit being manifest in our lives. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Because God is love, God is joy. God is joy. God is peace. God is patience. God is kindness. God is goodness. God is faithfulness. God is gentleness. God is self-control. When we encounter the holiness of God, that's what we encounter in his character. Because he's perfect in all his ways. And those are the characteristics we should want to manifest in our lives. What's the point? They're beautiful! And that's what we should want to be hoping, so that the aroma of our lives impacts those around us. We should pursue holiness. It really matters to God, and it matters, should matter, to us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do recognize the priority of holiness in who you are and what you ask us to be. We recognize that we all fall short of what you called us to be. That so many of those bad characteristics that we've read, either from Timothy or from the letters, and find manifestation in our lives. Forgive us. Help us to clothe ourselves in what matters to you. Help the fruit of the Spirit to be seen in our lives. And as we think and reflect on this coming week, Lord, we pray it will be your Holy Spirit that puts a finger on our lives as to how we are to respond. Us from hearing what other people think about us, but allow us to concentrate upon you and for you to work in us for your glory's sake. Amen. So we're going to close as we sing. When the music fades, they're always stripped away. Of holiness is coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. It's all about him.
About you. Jesus.
Okay.